Good afternoon, or good evening, or good morning, depending on where you are located, of course. My name is Peter Engels. I am the IOF regional representative for the MENA region. And on behalf of IOF, I would like to welcome you all to today's webinar on skeletal rare diseases, the next frontier for the bone doctor. This webinar will be presented by Professor Brandy, and it will be moderated by Professor Zakraoui. Now, before we kick off, I would like to remind you of some practicalities. This webinar will last approximately 1 hour. There will be 50 minutes for the presentation and about 10 minutes for questions and answers. If you want to submit a question, you can do so by clicking the questions link in the navigation panel and submitting the question to the group. Now, your questions can only be seen by the organizers, not by the other attendees. The questions will be read out to Professor Brandy so everyone can hear the question. This webinar is going to be automatically recorded, and you will receive an email with a link to the recorded webinar within a week following this webinar. Finally, once you have logged out of the webinar, you will receive an automatic email inviting you to complete a short survey. Now, completing this survey will not take you more than 3 minutes, so we would really appreciate if you could provide us with your feedback so we can improve the service and the quality of future webinars. Now, without further ado, I would like to give the floor to Professor Zakraoui, who will introduce today's speaker. Professor Zakraoui, the floor is yours.
Disorders. Her basic background is in molecular endocrinology applied to clinical medicine. She developed several novel cell biological models used in basic research worldwide. Her reputation in the area of bone and mineral metabolism is well recognized nationally and internationally. She owns 7 patents, and she published over 700 papers in peer-reviewed journals and 250 chapters in books. She has been and is the main investigator for several major applications granted for national and international agencies and institutions. She was the president of the Italian Society of Osteoporosis. She serves as a member of the scientific committee of the International Osteoporosis Foundation. She is general secretary of the European Society for Clinical and Economic Aspects of Osteoporosis and Osteoarthritis, and president of Fondazione Italiana per la Ricerca sulle malattie dell'osso. She is the editor-in-chief of clinical cases in mineral and bone metabolism. So, Professor Brandy, please give us your presentation. Thank you.
Good afternoon. As soon as I get my slides, I can start with the presentation. The people who are there, because that was not probably well planned by myself eventually. So the title of the presentation is Skeletal Rare Diseases, the Next Frontier for the Bone Doctor. We have to shorten the presentation eventually because we will not have enough time to go on with everything I prepared for you, but I think that will be enough at least to understand the topic. These are my disclosures. This presentation is based on activity that are carried on within IOF since 2011. That is the main team of the so-called Skeletal Rare Disease Working Group of the Committee of the Scientific Advisors. This group was set up at the time, and it includes a number of people, some also the people that eventually are listening to this presentation from the Middle East are present and are part of our group, and I thank them for their contribution and to set up also the idea of the whole webinar. The mission of the group is to dedicate the bone doctors, that are us in fact, on skeletal rare diseases in order to improve the diagnosis and the management of these disorders, mostly in the adult patients. Because very often, as doctors, we consider the rare disorders as disorders of the children. And in fact, in the most severe forms are the children that are affected. But in the case of our patients, eventually these patients can get into the adult age, either not diagnosed because the mutation of the gene is not so important, so relevant, to have a phenotype that is very severe, or they are children now transitioning to the adult age and they need to be taken care of by bone doctors. But we need to be educated because these disorders have rules that we have to follow, and there are limitations also on the therapies that we can do in these patients. The main activity of the IOF Skeletal Rare Disease Group has been working on education through a course that is called Skeletal Rare Disease Course of the IOF that has been running in different countries around the world. Very soon in the fall will be in Singapore. We had a course in Geneva, in St. Petersburg, in Israel, and so on. So we think that the course has been a very good expression of the educational activity, simply because in the course we have the possibility to interact directly with the doctors that participate in the course. One activity of the group was also to classify the skeletal rare diseases. And if we look at how this has been made as classification up to now, we can only say that there was a great heterogeneity in the classification of the almost 500 skeletal rare dysplasia. In fact, the definition of rarity, first of all, is a bureaucratic definition, because Europe and Canada, we consider rare a person that is one in 2,000 affected. In the USA, it's rare, it does affect more than 200,000 people in total. In Japan, it's rare, it affects no more than 50,000 people. In Australia, this is rare, it affects one in 10,000 people. And I don't know what happens in the Middle East, by the way. But that's the condition, that is heterogeneity. And we have to understand better also the term of rare, because what is rare? Rare is based on prevalence of the pathology, but there are differentiologies eventually. Not only all of them are eventually congenital, because there could be rare infections, rare tumors, rare degenerative conditions, and the disease could be considered initially rare, but then it can become in time a common disorder, like it happened in AIDS. And the disease can be considered rare, but the specific condition may not be so rare, like it happens in thalassemia. So you see, rarity is a concept that needs to be actually better qualified in terms of the concept that is behind it. And in fact, if you look at the numbers for rare bone diseases, we have, as I said, around 500. It will also include the synonyms. And there are different ways of classifying, again, these conditions. There is an ORFA code, the WCO code, an ICD code, the SNOMED code, and so on. And this jeopardizes the activity of the taxonomies. About 80 to 90% of cases are genetic, but one on three cases of the genetic causes is still unknown. So you see, it's a very high number, and in fact, the European region has been developing a European reference network that is fully dedicated to rare bone disorders, because these are so many different disorders. And many attempts have been made in the past to identify the disease groups within the rare bone disorders with a history on skeletal dysplasia taxonomy that goes back on the 70s and up to the most recent classification that includes skeletal rare dysplasia, metabolic bone disorders, dysostosis, and skeletal malformation, and also reduction syndromes. So different ways of classifying, with different approaches, mostly radiological, and eventually based on genes that encode proteins that are affected in these patients. There are many English websites of rare diseases that have databases that are constantly updated. So you see, a lot of efforts, but a lot of heterogeneity. There are also ways of classifying disorders in focused area of the skeletal rare bone disorders, like achondromatosis, were classified in 2010. Osteogenesis imperfecta were released. There are groups around the world that just classify the syndrome of sclerosing bone dysplasia. So, and this is another way of classifying, but still it doesn't include everything that we could be eventually interested on. The recent classification, in the past classification published in 2003, there was an approach that included also at the fourth line the disorders of skeletal homeostasis. That's something that is of great interest for us as bone doctors, because it is exactly homeostasis that we are working on when we look at very common disorders like osteoporosis. And that's the reason for which the skeletal rare disease of IOF embarked in an activity of classifying the metabolic bone disorders that are rare within the skeletal rare dysplasia. In fact, we have been able to identify over 100 different phenotypes that are with 86 different affected genes, where metabolism is the basis of the pathogenesis of the disorder. And why this is of interest for us? First of all, because metabolic targets can become very important pharmacological targets, as we will see later on during my presentation. And also because we study metabolism, and so we can apply our knowledge to this type of phenotypes that now are rare, and where we eventually, knowing the metabolic phenotype, can also intervene with the information that we have on pharmacology of the drugs that we commonly use in osteoporosis. That's just a table of this paper that, if you want, you can read and have an idea of the efforts we made in trying to classify the disorders as based on metabolism. And in this case, we were looking at the sclerosing forms, and you see that the classification is made having the homim phenotype number, the gene that is affected, the chromosome location, the phenotype of the patients, but the biochemical alterations are not characterized, but only in few of these disorders, because very often metabolism is overlooked in these patients. And that is what we can do much more and much better as bone doctors than the people that usually follow these patients that eventually don't have our same background that helps us in diagnosing metabolic these patients and also in treating them accordingly. Also, if you look at the metabolism that has been analyzed, we have so many ways of looking at metabolism, of bone and mineral metabolism, I'm saying, and also we have instruments that we can use in instrumental diagnosis that very often, eventually, pediatricians that eventually follow these patients in the young age don't use because they are not expert in bone disorders. And that's the reason for which our entering in this area can improve immensely the diagnosis and also the therapy of these patients, because we are very keen of using the means that we have available today in a very wise manner based on metabolism. Why then is it interesting for us to be bone doctors, not only of osteoporosis, but also of rare bone diseases? Because we can use the old drugs, for instance, anti-resorptives and bone-forming agents, with the capability of reading the metabolism of this patient. But it's also important because there are new drugs that, in fact, are metabolically targeted that we can use for the patients in the future and also now, and we can become the prescribers. However, if we don't know anything of what's happening in this area, eventually we will be out of the possibility of prescription and out also of the possibility of carrying clinical studies in these patients. So you see, I have now few examples that I want to offer you. One is the so-called hypophosphatasia. That is a disorder that is characterized biochemically by low alkaline phosphatase with high levels of the metabolic metabolites in the vitamin B6 metabolism. For instance, PLP, that is the vitamin B6, is very high in these patients where alkaline phosphatase is very low. Either the full molecule, a specific alkaline phosphatase, at the bond that is part of the non-specific alkaline phosphatase part. In this case, the gene is the one that encodes for the non-specific alkaline phosphatase that is mutated, and we have low levels of alkaline phosphatase and high levels of vitamin B6 because vitamin B6 needs to be dephosphorylated in order to enter the central nervous system, and then is rephosphorylated in the central nervous system. But if the alkaline phosphatase is not functioning, the vitamin stays in the serum, and we find high levels then of the vitamin B6 and low levels of alkaline phosphatase. This carry on a number of different type of complications in these patients, that in the children would be rickets, in the adults would be osteomalacia, non-healing fractures, osteoporosis, dental signs, a number of symptoms that involve also the muscle, the kidney, the lung, that are mostly, in the case of the lung, related to the children and to the very young neonates that suffer of respiratory insufficiency. Then you can have chondrocalcinosis, that is a kind of pseudogout in the patients, and also problems at the central nervous system related also to the problem of the lack of vitamin B6 that enters the central nervous system. So are phenotypes that eventually can meet along the way, but these patients not often are diagnosed because we don't look, and we tend to overlook the low levels of alkaline phosphatase. Now, this is the structure of the non-specific alkaline phosphatase, a very big protein, as all the enzymes, and there was the possibility to develop, through the efforts of the group of St. Louis, an enzyme that had a specific tropism for hydroxyapatite, and it was developed as a dimer, like the enzyme is, that now can substitute in this patient the alkaline phosphatase. And this made possible to develop the first clinical trials, mostly related to children with life-threatening disorder, mostly caused by respiratory distress, and with very good results at the end of this. So New England Journal of Medicine published the paper in 2012, and now we have this drug that is called Strensiq that we can now apply for hypophosphatasia in patients that are young up to 18 years of age, and then later on, depends on the countries of the reimbursement, also adult patients that are severe can be treated. And it's very important for us to know this because these patients develop mostly fractures at the long bones, like the foot bones, like the femur, like the tibia. And these patients, if we treat with antiresorptives, tend to develop even more fractures. Most of the fractures at the femur level are in fact atypical fractures, the mid-shaft fractures. So these patients really need to be recognized because we don't want to treat with antiresorptives patients that have already low levels of alkaline phosphatase. So that's an example that you have to keep in mind, because one patient like this can be eventually diagnosed by you. You can make then the genetic test, and remember that for the treatment, what justifies the treatment is not genetic mutation in this case, but is just the biochemistry and the phenotype. Then there is another big chapter that in the past few years became very popular, that is the so-called phosphate wasting disorders in adults. And this is an area that is very important because we know about phosphate now enough to analyze the problem of phosphate not as a forgotten mineral. We always have been very well educated on calcium levels, on calcium content in the diet. We never recommend anything regarding phosphate, just because phosphate is everywhere in our diet. However, there are conditions where phosphate decreases, and these are called phosphate wasting disorders. And now the phosphate becomes a very important mineral for us to know much better. And in fact, we knew that vitamin D was very important for bone for phosphate absorption at the gut level. But we now know much more than that, because other actors are coming and being part of this big picture. And the actor is now the FGF23 and the other phosphatonins, hormones that are produced by the osteocytes. They get into the blood and they increase the release of phosphate at the tubular level, making impossible the reabsorption of phosphate. This is done through a mechanism that includes a number of transporters, like the so-called sodium phosphate transporter type 2A and C, and this is done through receptors that are so-called the FGF receptor, because you recognize the FGF23, and the so-called Klotho receptor. And what the hormone does is not only it does not make possible reabsorption at the tubular level, so there is a hyperphosphaturia and the hypophosphatemia, but also decreases the production of the active vitamin D calcitriol, because it decreases the action of the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase. So we know this so much at these days that we can make diagnosis. And it's very important then to know that hypophosphatemia is important for the bone doctor, like hypophosphatasia. We need to look much more actively to the levels of alkaline phosphatase and to the levels of phosphate in our patients. And there are a number of mechanisms through which we can have hypophosphatemia. That could be the reduction of the intestinal absorption, like it happens in low levels of vitamin D, increase of renal excretion, like it happens in phosphate wasting disorders, or redistribution of phosphate inside the cells. And main causes of hypophosphatemia, in fact, are malnutrition, parenteral nutrition, alteration of the acid-basic equilibrium, mostly in acute patients, and mostly present in intensive care departments. Then we have other conditions like primary and secondary hyperparathyroidism, hungry bone syndrome, osteomalacia, rickets, malabsorption, and so on, where we can have a number of conditions that somehow influence the absorption or redistribution of phosphate in the body. Then there is the big chapter of the so-called phosphatonins, where we today can measure the circulating levels of fabulous growth factor 23. Remember that the hormone is produced by osteocytes and is active at the renal tubular level. And this can be often seen by the bone doctor, these conditions. So we need then to very much know about hypophosphatemia and to start to make differential diagnosis, because are patients that we can eventually encounter in our clinical practice. So we want to measure then in our patients serum folate calcium, PTH, 25-hydroxyD3, eventually to exclude possibilities of hyperparathyroidism, of osteomalacia. And then we have to measure the tubular maximal reabsorption of phosphate. And when we measure this, we are able then to see that there are patients eventually that lose too much of phosphate in the urines. And we want to measure in this case also the levels of 1,25-hydroxyvitamin D3, because if FGF23 is too high, these patients will have very low levels of 1,25, because 1-alpha-hydroxylase is inhibited. And FGF23 levels can measure it in the circulation, and then we can make a genetic test. So you see, there are tests that we can use in our clinical practice, and some of these are accessible to the majority of centers. And if we look now to the different conditions with regular tubular, renal tubular phosphate wasting, where the FGF23 levels is high, you see how many different conditions with how many different genes. And these are the congenital conditions, but we have an acquired form, that is the so-called tumor-induced osteomalacia, where we have tumors, and this acquired and usually is in the young adults. And it happens that these patients develop tumors that we call strange tumors, strange places, and they have this loss of phosphate, and there is no genetic mutation that is acquired, and now we have to find the tumor. And sometimes CR23 is high in these patients, or else it couldn't be high because the tumor expressed other phosphatonins that are not measurable in the circulation at this date. So you see how much we can do in these disorders, because we can look at this patient, the adult patient, as our patient. This can be a patient that is transitioning from a so-called condition that is called XLH, where we have an X-linked rickets, very severe in the patients, that they are treated with a drug, as I will show you later on, and then they transition in the adult. Or we can have a patient affected that was fine until a certain moment, and then he comes to us, and he has muscle problems, bone problems, he fractures, and we have to do something with this patient, and we have to make the diagnosis. So you see, at these days, we developed also an algorithm that you can find in the papers that have been published recently in Natural Nephrology. There is a very nice review on this. And you have an algorithm with low serum phosphate, and then you measure parathyroid hormone. Depends if it's elevated or normal, you go on, and now you get to the diagnosis, and you make a differential diagnosis in this condition. And as I said, This webinar was built up to give you a taste of how many other possibilities, but certainly not to develop everything on XLH, because XLH per se is a disorder that will actually need a webinar fully dedicated. IOF was able to develop an informative brochure on X-linked hypophosphatemia, that is a congenital condition, but I have to say that even though it's rare, 1 to 10,000 births, actually we have seen patients that we diagnosed in the adult age because they were never diagnosed as children, because the form was not so severe. The phenotype was acceptable. Their legs were not perfect, but no one took care of until they came to us. And they were actually, their phosphate levels were 1.2, 1.3, 1.5. And we took care of the patients and making the diagnosis. Now we have a therapy for this disorder, that is burosumab, a therapy that we can use in children up to the 18th year of age, and is an antibody that blocks FGF23. That has been developed for X-linked hypophosphatemia, because this disorder is in fact caused by mutation in which FGF23, that is a phosphaturic hormone, now is increased in this patient because genetically the hormone is produced in excess because there is not inhibition in its production. But burosumab is now available also to treat other patients eventually, and in the future clinical studies will be carried on TIO patients, the tumor-induced osteomalacia, and the big actors in this are the bone doctors, because those patients will be seen by us. Each one of you probably has seen one of these patients in his or her medical experience and life, and certainly this is an area of great importance. There is the drug that is now is available, obviously, in the United States, where it has been developed, but in Europe, it was approved in Europe with the name of Crysvita in 2018. Is an antibody that blocks the hormone that is produced in excess. Let's see what we can conclude, that phosphate wasting disorders represent a very important chapter in the mineral metabolism experience of the doctors. The conventional therapy that is offering phosphate salts and calcitriol, obviously, to these patients because they do not produce active vitamin D, does not solve the problem of the patients. And burosumab is a new therapy that can help to treat these patients, and that to say that we are using now in patients affected by XLH, and obviously we want to use also in patients affected by TIO until the tumor is not localized. Then there are other areas of interest for the bone doctors, mostly physician endocrinologists, that is the area of hypoparathyroidism. Parathyroid hormone is a very important hormone. Hypoparathyroidism is a very difficult disease to be managed. There are many different genetic conditions that are the basis of hypoparathyroidism. About 10% of the forms are congenital, and the majority of them are acquired after surgery at the neck level, but still is a rare disorder because one in 2,500 of the population in Europe is affected by hypoparathyroidism, and that makes the disorder rare. We can use the calcium and vitamin D in these patients, but we have now PTH1 to 84 that is called NADPAR in Europe, and we can use this drug when the patient do not respond to the so-called conventional therapy that was not a substitutive therapy because we were not substituting the hormone that was missing, and that was the only endocrine disorder that was left without a substitutive therapy. At these days, patients that are not controlled adequately with the conventional therapy can be put in therapy with NADPAR. There are in the future many different possibilities, and I want you doctors working in the bone area to be very much involved in rare disorders. There are disorders like this one that is a very rare disorder, one in 200,000 of the population, that is so-called osteoporosis pseudoglioma syndrome. Very, very severe disease for these patients, fracture and blindness. But in these patients, what we have is a problem of an excess of production of sclerostin. So we know that sclerostin is through the wind and the Fritzl receptor is the inhibitor of the formation. We have an excess of inhibition of formation of bone. We have osteoporosis, and therefore the development of an antibody in this direction could help eventually also these patients, because in these patients actually we have a mutation of the receptor LRP5 that is an activating mutation. So in the animal models, reducing the protein that in fact impact on this receptor could have shown to be positive, and there are few patients now that are treated around the world with the antibody against sclerostin, trying to improve the blue phenotype on this patient. And there is also the possibility in the future to have not only the antibody against the phosphatonin FGF23, but the FGF23 itself, because we have other disorders that mirror the phosphate wasting disorders that are the disorders with hyperphosphatemia. And these disorders, the FGF23 peptide is reduced because the mutation of the genes does not allow the production of the hormone anymore. So these patients then are hyperphosphatemic and hypophosphaturic. And in the future, the hormone FGF23 could help these patients to solve very severe problems for which they have suffered. And in the area of hypoparathyroidism, we have calcilytic that are now under evaluation to be developed in the therapy of this disorder. And calcilytics help because they can increase the production by the parathyroid cells of the small quantity of parathyroid hormone that they can still produce even in certain phases of hypoparathyroidism. And then we have new parathyroid hormone formulations, not only in NADPAR, but also different different formulations like drugs that can be longer acting, or they can be oral production of PTH1 to 34, or they can be also prodrug of parathyroid hormone that can be released much more slowly, and they can be offered to this patient. And this is what I really wanted to tell you, because I think that is very important. I have a very big group of people working with me, and everything I've done in all these years was thanks to them, and I have to thank my group. And I want to tell you that in all my group, I have doctors that are very good in taking care of the patients. As osteoporosis patients, we have been involved in the majority of the clinical registration trials for osteoporosis, but they reason as well about genes, about rare disorders, and this made them just much better doctors, because they do something that seems more simple, like the common, I would say, quoted osteoporosis, but they can treat also patients that are affected by rare disorders. They know about the drugs, they know how they are prescribed, they are very much involved in knowledge, and this is what I really want to bring in this community of IOF and the community that are interested in learning more is about rare disorders as part of the activity of the bone doctor. If you need anything then related to patients, to something you want to know more, and to something we can help you into, that could be a genetic test, you write me, you find there my email, and I will try to help you as much as we can because we receive so many patients and requests from outside of Italy and most of all from the area of Middle East that we are very interested in collaborating and helping more. So that is my presentation. I think there is now time for the questions. Thanks for your attention.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Brandi, for this wonderful presentation. To the participants to this webinar, sorry again for the technical hiccup at the start of this webinar. We now have room for a number of questions. As I mentioned during the presentation introduction, you can submit your questions by using the questions button on the navigation panel. We do have some questions in already, and I will read out one of the questions to Professor Brandi, and then she will reply with the answer to the entire group. So the first question would be, how is it possible to make genetic tests in these patients?
Today is not easy when we find a patient that is not classical, like let's say osteogenesis imperfecta with blue sclera, with Kaffele, skin
Mission.
results. Then in those cases, it's easy. Eventually, we can suspect osteogenesis imperfecta, and we go ahead with the genes that are responsible for osteogenesis imperfecta. Because osteogenesis imperfecta is a big array of different disorders with different genes that are responsible. But sometimes we have just fragility. And what can we do in that case? We are not so well oriented, but we understand that we have a young fellow that was fractured when he was very young. So the best at today would be just to do exome analysis. That is not available everywhere in the world. So that's the reason for which we are available for very well-characterized clinical cases to give some consultancy to the centers that have some difficulties locally in order to better orient the genetic test and eventually go also into exome analysis because today it can be done and then we look at your genome, at least in the whole area that are encoded, are encoding proteins, so the exome area.
Okay, thank you. Another question somebody is asking, where can you discuss difficult clinical cases? Are there any dedicated platforms to do so?
That was originally an idea that that we had also within the scientific committee of the IOF. I remember Sergio Ferrari was indicating this as a very important tool, and that's not easy, as you can imagine, because you need to have dedicated doctors. At the European level, the so-called bone EARN, that is the EARN fully dedicated to bone disorders, is now developing platforms for consultancy. And I think that is the way to go in the future because then the patients and the doctors that follow this patient can engage themselves in questions and then eventually the best doctor discussing a given case. So that is going to be available in the future. It's still on trial, as you can imagine, because it's not easy. And even though the platform has been developed, there is so much work to be done. And what I suggest always to the doctors when they have a difficult case is really to go to the experts that they can recognize and ask for help. Because the best thing for your patients is to give some answers. So we are available. We have, as I just shown you, we are a very big group from all over the world of people that are expert in the disorders, or they are more expert than the general population of the bone doctors. And I think that is good to us because these are rare disorders and they need to be followed on by most of all diagnosed in a way that is the most efficient for the patient. So, and you are going to be learning along the way, and that's important for any doctor.
Okay, thank you for that answer, Professor. We have another question. Somebody is asking, what do you think about parathyroid transplantation for persistent hypoparathyroidism?
Oh, that's a fascinating question and a very very good one. Still, I am not going to be very encouraging in this direction. No, my area of expertise is parathyroid cell biology, so you can imagine how much for me was of interest to develop a cellular system to be transferred to patients first. It's not easy if you do heterotransplantation. There are ways and approaches that created a kind of film around the cells, and then you implant these, I would say, spheres within these spheres. There are cells that can survive for a certain time, and they can distribute the hormone outside of the sphere because the sphere makes possible the transition of peptides, but then the cells die. And that's the only possibility to make a natural transplantation, because otherwise you will have to treat these patients with inhibitors of rejection. That would be a very heavy therapy, when today we have parathyroid hormone peptides that can potentially be helping the patients, and much more in the future when we will have different delivery systems in the area of hypoparathyroid. We are witnessing a revolution that's very similar to when diabetes started to be treated with insulin. So it's a very big area that is very much developing, and therefore I suppose that all the efforts that were made originally to develop transplantation models are going to be substituted by a substitution therapy to this.
Okay, thank you for that answer, Professor. Another question from the floor. Are the newly developed drugs, are they available all around the world?
That's another project we have within the IOF Scleral Rare Disease Group, that is, in fact, to make sure that we recognize better which one is the situation around the world. Because it's so bad, the patients cannot get the same type of tools to cure themselves in one country and another. This is even worse when it happens for rare disorders. Because we have children that can die in the first days of life, they are not treated, and there is no treatment. You know, you can cry for your child, but if you know that there is a treatment that is not available, that's not good. So in order to picture this, we are going to engage with a number of molecules, the other ones that I showed you, for the future, because it's true, they're not available everywhere. They are available also, and when they are available in different countries, they are available under reimbursement that are totally different, like it happens in Europe. Europe is not the same. This is the European agency that approves for all Europe, but then any country does what it does. And it depends very much on resources, depends very much on the interest on a given disorders, depends on something that is environment more than the patient itself. So it's a very good question. I have to say that there is a heterogeneity that for me is not acceptable for conditions that are severe, but now can become really affordable, and the patients can live long in a very good quality of life.
Okay.
Professor.
Yeah. Yes, please go
Professor
ahead.
Brandy, another question. Yeah. Another question is on, is bone metabolism a good way to diagnose these patients and to treat them accordingly?
Yes, because, for instance, I made you the explanation of hypophosphatasia. When you have the low levels of alkaline phosphatase, that could be, if you measure the total alkaline phosphatase, equal or lower than 40 units. And now you have this patient, you already have an information that is low levels of alkaline phosphatase. What do I have to do? I want to look eventually to vitamin B6 and to see if this is high. I want to make sure that I'm not treating this patient that eventually already fractured with a drug that is reducing the alkaline phosphatase, because I suspect that many of the so-called atypical fractures could derive from low turnover in these patients, or patients that were treated chronically and long-term with both antiresorptives. The same story is for a patient that comes to you at a young age. You know that the patient fractures, you make the bone metabolism profile, you find that this patient is high turnover patient, and now you treat the patients with antiresorptives, even if it's not osteogenesis imperfecta, because you have to help that patient, and the metabolism of that patient tells you that the patient is too high bone turnover. For us, this is possible because we know the drugs that we are using for osteoporosis, but this becomes very difficult for doctors that not routinely use this type of drugs. And that's the reason for which we are able to solve problems, and other doctors are not able to solve problems in these patients. And please remember always to look also at the levels of phosphate in the serum, because that's such an important tool. Metabolism drives any decision. If we make a good study of the patient on and its metabolism, then we can eventually use the drugs that we already have available, because we are talking about more than 500 different disorders, over 100 disorders are metabolic, and we have drugs only for three of those.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Brandi. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Professor Brandi, for this wonderful presentation, and thank you, Professor Zakraoui, for moderating today's webinar. There is no more questions from the floor, so this webinar is going to close off. I would like to thank all the participants again for attending this webinar, and I would like to ask you one more time to please give your feedback once you receive the email with the link to the survey, because it is important for us to improve service and quality of future webinars. I wish you all a great weekend, and I would like to thank you again on behalf of IOF for joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.